Sir, who is the first to go, sir?
We are live.
Okay, you are live.
So, welcome everybody to this webinar today. And this is a webinar in our series as to when a operation comes, what can, there's some echo there. Can we? So this is a walk-in series, that is when a walk-in patient with OPD comes into retina, what should be your approach and when should you treat it and how should you treat it and when should you refer. So this is an initiative by the All India Ophthalmological Society as well as by the Allergan, and we are thankful to Allergan for supporting this. We have a whole galaxy of speakers today with us. I'm unable to share my screen.
Shall I do it?
Well, yeah, yeah. Please, Rajesh, can you carry it?
Yeah. I'll keep changing the slides. You go ahead.
I think there's some problem. I'm getting some this thing on the... Can you carry on, Rajesh?
Okay, okay. That's fine.
Please introduce.
Okay. So... I welcome you all in this walk-in retina patient in your OPD webinar, how to diagnose and when to refer. So what is all about in this webinar and speakers with, you know, being the VRSI secretary, Dr. Raja Narayanan, who is currently working as senior consultant at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute. He is head of clinical research, L.V. Prasad Eye Institute, and adjunct professor, University of Rochester, School of Medicine and Dentistry. He has more than 100 publications in national and international peer-reviewed journals. He has various awards to his credit and has done many international and national presentations. He has keen interest in hospital management and certified in various processes, including Six Sigma. He has delivered talks at various leading national and international business schools. And he is also examiner for FNB, retina specialty, and principal investigators for various international and multicentric trials. Along with him, we have the moderator, Dr. Naresh Babu, who is an excellent surgeon, a good friend. He is chief of retina vitreous service Arvind Eye Hospital and Postgraduate Institute of Ophthalmology. He has done his specialty training from Jipmer, Pondicherry, and done fellowship in vitreo retina at Arvind Eye Hospital, and then became medical officer and is also a retina consultant at the Retina Vitreous Services of Arvind Eye Hospital and Postgraduate Institute of Ophthalmology, and is involved in multiple projects which are being done at Arvind Eye Hospital. Of course, we have the very dynamic General Secretary of AIOS, Professor Namrata Sharma, who needs no introduction. She's the Professor of Ophthalmology at the Cornea, Cataract and Refractive Surgery Services at RP Center, AIIMS, and has more than nearly 500 publications to her credit and a thoroughly academic person. This is me. I'm Dr. Rajesh Sinha, working as professor in the Cornea, Lens and Refractive Surgery Services at RP Center, AIIMS, and the honorary treasurer of AIOS. Then we have a very young and dynamic speaker in Dr. Srinivas Joshi, who has done his fellowship in vitreo retina from University of Toronto, North America, and has also done pediatric retinal surgery training at Sick Kids Hospital, Toronto. And he's presently working as vitreo retina consultant and director for research at M.M. Joshi Eye Institute, Hubli. He's also a member of AIOS ARC South Zone and has many awards and publications, notable awards being the Red Buckler Award by the American Society and recipient of Senior Honor Award by American Society of Retina Specialists. And he is into all academics and retinal surgeries and is a very good orator. We have another dynamic and very good surgeon, Dr. Vishal Agarwal, who is practicing at Jaipur, initially got training at RP Center AIIMS, and then did vitreo retinal fellowship at Shankar Nethralaya Chennai. is currently the Honorary Secretary of Jaipur Ophthalmological Society and a Professor of Ophthalmology at SMS Medical College, Jaipur, Rajasthan. And he has many awards, which includes the Red Buckler Best Video Award, the American Society of Retina Specialists, AIOS Ophthalmic Hero Award, and he has received C.S. Reshmi Award, which is a very prestigious award, and many other awards at the state level and at the city level. And along with it, with us, we have Colonel S.K. Mishra, who is a very dear friend and a dynamic head of the department at the R&R Hospital, Army Hospital at New Delhi. He is a very good retina surgeon, has been trained at RP Center also, and has been decorated with Vishisht Seva Medal, which is awarded to recognize distinguished service to a high order to all ranks of Indian Armed Forces. He is currently the head of the department and an alumni of head of the department at R&R Hospital, New Delhi, and is an alumni of AFMC Pune and has many publications and awards to his credit. We have Dr. Darius Shroff, who is perhaps the youngest, but a very dynamic retina surgeon. He is working as medical director at Shroff Eye Center, New Delhi, India. He did his graduation and post-graduation from Maulana Azad Medical College and did a vitreo retinal surgical fellowship from Shankar Netralay and then did the FRCS. He has presented various papers at various international and national forums, and he has many publications as well. He has received the prestigious Red Buckler Trophy at the annual meeting of the American Society of Retina Specialists in San Francisco in 2016, has received various awards at the national level and has many publications. And of course, we have Dr. Deeksha Katoch, who is again a young and dynamic retina surgeon. She is currently assistant professor at the Vitreo Retinal Services Retinopathy of Prematurity at the Department of Ophthalmology Advanced Eye Center, PGI Chandigarh. And she has done her MBBS from Chandigarh GMCH, MS Ophthalmology from PGI Chandigarh, and senior residency again from PGI Chandigarh. And she has numerous publications, 52 index publications, 7 chapters in textbooks, and currently the Joint Secretary of Chandigarh Ophthalmological Society. And she has special interest in retinopathy of prematurity and pediatric medical and surgical retina. So we welcome you.
I think Rajesh's network is gone.
Thank you all, and hand over the proceedings to the chairman.
Dr. Raja Narayan, can you take over?
Sure. Thank you so much, Dr. Namrata and Dr. Sinha, and for this very important and very practically oriented session. This is going to be for all general ophthalmologists who want to diagnose or treat common retinal conditions or also when to refer. And for this kind of situation, we have probably one of the best. I don't think we can have anyone more practical as Dr. Naresh Babu, who will be moderating this session, who is an excellent surgeon, which has already been mentioned by Dr. Sinha. But I can add that he's an excellent moderator. He's very practical, very innovative, and he's a ground level person. So, you know, in all our clinics and clinical practice, we need, not everyone has that kind of mindset or an attitude for ground level practical innovations. And Dr. Naresh Babu is one of the best in that. I request him to take over the proceedings and start with the first talk.
Am I audible? Thank you, Dr. Raja.
Yes, you are audible. You are audible, Dr. Naveed. No, it's muted now again, Dr. Naveed.
Yes.
There is an echo, I think.
Now it's okay. Thank you, Dr. Raja, for those kind words, actually. In fact, I was not really aware what to this thing. Today's first on the medical retina practice for general ophthalmologist. Actually, many a times it's always a problem, like when to refer and when not to refer. So many a times, for the fear of being retained, many a times the cases are retained by the general ophthalmologist for a longer time, and by the time it is referred to us, it's too late. And it's going to be a wonderful talk, I think, hopefully by Dr. Srinivas Joshi, in case of medical practice, in retina practice, when to send the patient to us, how early should be done by the general ophthalmologist. Over to Dr. Srinivas Joshi.
Thank you, Naresh sir. And I would like to thank AIOS, Dr. Namrata Madam, Dr. Sinha sir for the wonderful introduction, and also Dr. Narayanan sir and Dr. Naresh sir. My greetings to all the co-colleagues and the speakers. Thanks to Alarkan for this wonderful meeting. So if you look into the article published in IJO, that is the Comprehensive Eye Care Issues, Challenges and the Way Forward. So now there is a trend that we need to move from a disease-specific care model towards the comprehensive eye care. So that is, there is need for a more holistic, integrated approach involving the health system. It encompasses not only the treatment, but also prevention, promotion, and rehabilitation of incurable blindness. It's a very good article published just this year in the, January. So if you look into the triad, comprehensive eye examination includes visual acuity, anterior segment, and posterior segment, whereas eye care services also includes promotion, prevention, diagnosis, treatment of eye diseases, and also most importantly is the rehabilitation of those with irreversible blindness, especially with the low vision aids. And then comes the eye care system, where designed to provide services equally to different groups, irrespective of the complexity and the cost of the care. So only a few countries have actually planned for defined public health approaches, and screening programs have been proposed for DR, AMD, glaucoma, refractive. However, still there is a limitation of access and accessibility in the developing countries. So for the general ophthalmologist to approach the retina, I have divided, try to simplify it into three groups. That is one looking at the disc and then at the macula and then go towards the periphery. So coming to a case of disc edema, all of us should know that the most common cause of disc edema is non-arthritic AION, which falls into 35% of the cases. Then comes the optic neuritis and the intracranial cause. So whenever we say disc edema, when you say it as unilateral, these are the few causes like demyelinating, non-arthritic, diabetic papillopathy or vein occlusion. And bilateral is usually when we try to have disc edema in both the sides, that is papillary edema and malignant hypertension. So this, you can see a case of non-arthritic AION disc picture. Now you go in for the papillary edema, where you can see the peripapillary hemorrhages, and then you go in for the malignant hypertension. So whenever there is kind of cotton wool spots, what we call it as an NFL infarcts, along with the tortuosity of these vessels, the first thing which should come to our mind along with the disc edema is the malignant hypertension. Although this condition is bilateral, we need to look into both the funduses to arrive at the diagnosis and check the BP as well. So when we look into the onset of the visual loss, usually the vascular or the traumatic usually falls between seconds to minutes. And then comes the inflammatory cause, space occupying or the chronic degenerative, and then the elevated intracranial pressure. So these usually happens within hours to weeks. So that's how we divide it as hyperacute, acute, subacute, and chronic and progressive. So when we look into a case of papillary edema, look for the features of raised ICT. So what are the features? Morning headache, which is persisting, intensifies with cough, strain, projectile vomiting, and motor rigidity. So it can happen because of the edema, bleeding in the brain, or because of the space occupying lesions, or CSF, or hydrocephalus. So what the disc will show? Elevation of the optic disc, that is quantification by direct ophthalmoscope. Most of us, it's in clinical practice, it's definitely easy to pick up. Three diopters means we usually measure it as 1 mm. So there will be a blurring of the disc margin here. Peripapillary fibers show some swelling. And most important is when we try to look into these Patton's lines. So that gives an indication that there is a disc edema. And of course, this has to be examined by 90D or 78D only. So when to suspect vascular etiology? When there is hyperemia associated along with the disc blurring, If then there is venous congestion, extensive hemorrhages around the disc, exudates, cotton wool spots, and no spontaneous venous pulsation. So when we try to differentiate between papilledema and papillitis, so optic nerve functions are normal, whereas in papillitis, it is disturbed. Papilledema is usually a term when we use for bilateral conditions, but papillitis can happen unilaterally. Peripapillary hemorrhages are more in case of papilledema, whereas in papillitis, if we see, there are less. So this is the how the picture goes. This is the case of papilledema, disc margin blurring, hyperemia around the disc, and the peripapillary hemorrhages are also seen. And in the case of papillitis, it's not as compared to the papilledema. Now, when we, I just explained, when we have a case with the cotton wool spots, disc edema, and also sometimes when we see these hard exudates around the macula, which is in the called a macular star appearance, which we call, then we call it as a neuroretinopathy, that when there is a disc edema, multiple cotton wool spots, hard exudates, and macular star. So when it happens, it usually happens in the young smokers and uncontrolled hypertension. There is severe attenuation of arteriole, and it's also associated with renal insufficiency, stroke, MI, or even death. So it has to be treated early. That is grade 4 hypertensive. So optic neuritis, typical and atypical. Typical usually happens in the case of young. Multiple sclerosis is usually the cause, and MRI might be the only required investigation most of the times. So when we come to the atypical, there is a marked disc swelling. There can be a vitritis, progressive loss of vision, and most importantly, there is lack of partial recovery, which usually happens well with the optic neuritis. But in atypical, it doesn't, even with the help of the steroids as well. So it requires a myriad of investigations, which I'll just showing in the slide. And these are the pictures. The optic neuritis can be nowhere from not a much of disc edema to the moderate amount of disc swelling. And this is the case of atypical, where we definitely have a disc edema, peripapillary hemorrhages, and sometimes it might be associated with neuroretinitis as well. So I'll not go into the detail. Just in the fundus examination, we need to know typical usually is this fundus is normal in 2/3 of the cases, and diffuse edema without hemorrhages is seen in 1/3 of the cases. So when we quickly look into the ischemic optic neuropathy, arteritic and non-arteritic is not very difficult to diagnose, because arteritic is usually associated with pain. Look for the jaw pain, claudication, headache, and the bright light nystagmus, and it's an ophthalmic emergency. So it has to be referred very early. Non-arteritic, that is no overt symptoms. It's usually associated with hypertension, diabetes mellitus, hypercholesterolemia. So here you can see the case of non-arteritic in the left side, the swelling of the optic disc associated with the flame-shaped hemorrhages. Whereas in arteritic AION, we usually see the pallid swelling of the disc and the peripapillary cotton wool spot, which is more in favor of arteritic. So coming lastly, in the disc, pseudo-disc edema, you have optic nerve head drusen. It also causes disc elevation, and medullated nerve fiber, where it looks like a bird disc margin, which is actually not. Tilted disc might also look like a bird disc margin. In case of morning glory, also it looks like an elevated disc of dysplasia and Burmeister's papillae. So these are the various differential diagnosis for, or it's called a pseudo-disc edema. So coming to the next is macula. The most important disease that should not be missed quickly, I'll run through in 3 minutes, is CSCR. Very easily missed, as the other ocular features are unremarkable, but chronic CSCR can lead to reversible loss if not managed properly. So how it is seen? Usually the patients complain of blurry vision. When we look into the fundus photograph, there is usually some amount of elevation at the posterior pole, or sometimes some authors refer it as a blister of the fluid at around the foveal area. Additional symptoms, the patients might say that there is metamorphopsia, there is the objects appear farther away, the whites may appear duller, and most importantly, it might not produce symptoms all the time. So there are various causes. It can be steroid use, type A personality, Helicobacter, obstructive sleep apnea. They are all associated with CSC. So coming to whether a general ophthalmologist should have an OCT in his practice, but in present days going on and where we are looking at treating at the retinal conditions, I think OCT is a must. Now we are getting cost-effective OCTs. There are various companies which are looking into try to do a bundling or try to give a breakup for the beginners. I think OCT is an important tool for any medical retina practice. So see here you can see the area of shaggy photoreceptors, this is the subretinal fluid. And again, if you see a chronic CSC, you can see fibrinous like thing, but OCT here, it gives you a clue. Even though you don't have an FA, sometimes features like this, which we call it as an RP epithelium aperture, which usually indicates the leak which is happening at that point. And then you can see SREMS, hyperreflectivity in the subretinal area. So that's usually a kind of fibrinous exudate. So OCT, yes, definitely. I think we can have it in the discussion. It is a must for medical retina practice. So coming to the AMD is one of the most researched and rapidly advancing disease. And as a general ophthalmologist, we should know the basics of the disease, because also it is important to screen before any cataract surgery, as it makes the choice for the IOL and when to suspect. I think the later presenters will be doing that. So just to touch a brief, dry AMD, you can see some pigment clumping, you can see the drusens here, and in advanced stages, you can have a geographical atrophy. As depicted in the OCT, you can see there's loss of the outer retinal layers. In case of AMD, you can see the subretinal hemorrhage here, along with the drusens can be seen, which is very conclusive of wet AMD. So this is another interesting article that, along with the diabetic retinopathy, we should also add screening of age-related macular degeneration to the current screening programs. So category, patients without any clinical evidence of macular diseases are suited for all IOL technologies, whereas early maculopathy, that is soft drusen or pigmentary changes with relative sparing, it's difficult counseling, but it is relative contraindication for the multifocal IOLs and the accommodating IOLs, because multifocal IOLs, as we all know, causes loss of contrast sensitivity at lower spatial frequencies. But in case of presence of drusens or geographical atrophy or exudative changes, multifocal IOL is definitely no monofocal or the toric IOLs. So coming to the next is the quickly last two diseases. Macular hole, very important to differentiate from a pseudo hole to the macular hole. The left picture shows a pseudo hole. A simple Watsky Allen test where the patient complains of the missing line can be done. And this is the true hole. But again, OCT is a deciding factor which gives you a definite indication whether there is a hole or no, because macular hole most of the time needs surgical intervention. So coming to the case of diabetic retinopathy, I'll not go into the detail. As a general ophthalmologist, most of us definitely know about diabetic retinopathy. The various screening programs now in the case of teleophthalmology is going on. The various classification, the international classification, we all know about it. But coming to the diabetic macular edema, now we are dividing it into non-central and central involving DME. So that is the basis of the treatment, because usually non-central, we go in for the laser, and central involving the treatment of choice is now intravitreal anti-VEGFs or the steroids. So the most important, which I want to touch here, is when we have a 6/12 vision or worse, then they needs to be referred, but not that urgent. But whenever it comes to severe NPDR, DME or PDR, then these cases have to be referred to a vitreoretinal surgeon, unless you have an OCT or the laser practice at your clinic. So how frequently we need to screen these patients? Usually moderate to mild to moderate, they can be done from 6 to 12 months. But when it comes to severe, it is less than 3 months, and PDR is less than 1 month. This is how the frequent referrals are required in these kind of patients. So coming to the next is hypertensive, last few slides. So stress again is increasing with current lifestyle conditions. So is the hypertension. And there are various classification, central, branch, hemicentral. They're divided again, each one of them subsector as non-ischemic and ischemic. And again, when we see in a sectoral part, we call it as a branch retinal vein occlusion. When we see something picture like this, that we call it as a blood and the thunder appearance, is usually a case of ischemic CRVOs. And the patients with RVO usually have 30-fold high risk of post-op CME in case of cataract surgeries. So detailed workup is definitely required, suspected inflammatory, CBC, homocysteine, anticardiolipin. And the general guidelines is treat any associated intraocular neovascularization with PRP, treat associated macular edema if visually significant with intravitreal injections of the steroids, and lower the IOP if needed, and we need to treat the underlying medical condition. So other macular disorders, whether it's trauma, uveitis, infectious, post-surgery, then it's always better to refer to a VR specialist. So I would like to acknowledge Department of Vitreoretina and my fellow Dr. Karthikeya Singh. And this is the small last slide. If you can see here, it's like a blind man. When they try to touch an elephant, one say it's a wall, it's a tree, it's a snake, it's a spear, it's a fan. So this is not how we look or treat at the retina. It's not just the disc we need to look at, the macula or the periphery. It has to be looked as a whole to have a proper diagnosis. And that is what any vitreoretinal surgeon or the medical practice would like to want it as. So with this, I would like to... my presentation. Thank you very much, AIOS and Alargan, for allowing me to present a few of the slides.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. Dr. Raja, we're going with the questions now or later?
You can ask questions now.
Okay. Dr. Srinivas, the first problem which we come across when the cases are referred by general practitioners, with all due respect, is like they send the patients with OCT, and that will be just a printout, and it is very difficult to interpret anything with that a single printout. So we ask them to, what you call, repeat those tests, FFA usually, and as well as the OCT. So the people are very unhappy. So how do you manage such a situation? So how to counsel them?
It's a very, very practical question, sir. It's a, I daily come across this situation. So what I try to explain is the OCT is not just one cut scan, which they try to give it in the pictures. I just showed them the other patient's OCT where I try to do it, where it's a spectral domain or the swept source OCT. This has a higher detail depth, and this is based for your treatment itself. And most importantly, when the conditions need treatment, when you try to get it into the OCT of our system, then it gives a comparative between the pre and the post treatment, and the machine itself try to give a comparison. These are the few counseling points I usually try to stress to the patients to get it done at the place where they are showing for the VR practice.
Yeah, so is it the problem of the referring doctor or the problem of the person to whom it is referred? Because when we ask them to repeat, they feel annoyed and they say, we have already done it actually. So
I totally agree with your point, sir, but I usually request our patients, I know most of that very practical question it is what you are telling me, but unfortunately I try to tell my patients that you have to shell out a little bit more for detailed understanding, and that's the reason why you have been sent here. And that is the reason why we need to look at them and we need to treat them. The underlying cause is a few of these. I think most 3/4 of my patients do agree with that, but 1/4 still remain unhappy. And in those cases, I just try to do it free of cost, sir.
And the second thing is like regarding this hypertensive retinopathy, it's a very dicey thing. Like many a times we suspect hypertensive retinopathy and it is our paramedics who are doing the blood pressure. So now actually it is mandatory in our place when we suspect anything to do with blood pressure, the BP should be done by a resident or by ourselves. So how do you do it in your practice? Because many a times it is, especially when the blood pressure is very high, the people, the paramedics may not appreciate the gap in the coroscope, so they give a wrong BP. So how do you manage that?
Very valid point again, sir. Again, a good question. But nowadays, I don't know if many will agree with that. Of course, sphygmomanometer is definitely the way, the gold standard method. But now we have shifted to the electronic way of BP monitoring. So whether it's we do it or the technicians do it, I think I usually ask them to take 3 average. And it's a just kind of screening whether they are hypertensive or not hypertensive. Usually when they try to show in some diastolic pressure higher, and that is when I refer to a physician and then they can take a good care of them. Or when they are confirmed with the electronic, I usually try to do it myself using the sphygmomanometer.
Yeah. So there are so many questions. I'll just end up with the last one. How do you communicate back with the people who are referring to you? Because communicating back with them actually correct so many things, because I'm sorry to say, like I've come across a few cases where CSR is treated with steroids and sent to us also with due respect actually. So when we communicate back, it is better to correct the things also. So how do you communicate back? What are the modalities you use for communicating back with the physicians?
Very, 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 very practical and important question required in today's practice, sir. So what usually earlier we used to have our own integrated software, where the referring doctor itself gets come into that software, and whatever we need to send a referral, it usually goes by the mail. So nowadays, what I'm doing is take a screenshot of the file paper and just trying to WhatsApp them. I think WhatsApp is now becoming a good care of thing, but if it is integrated into our MRD or the medical record softwares, then that is the best method, because they can get a good access about what was the vision right from beginning to the end and what disease has been done. But I usually try to do it at the end of the day. I usually tell my technicians or the OPD assistants to keep those referred cases separately. And I personally take up the pictures and send it to them. This is how I do it, which I feel it easy for me, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Srinivas. Over to you, Raja.
Yeah, very nice present. Just final comment. I think we're running out of time. Excellent presentation, Srinivas. You covered, especially your last slide about the elephant, and you know, everyone looks at it in a different way. For general ophthalmologists, whenever they look at cataract, there are some guidelines as to when they should suspect that there can be some other pathology other than cataract. First of all, I would like to say torchlight examination is no longer an acceptable standard as of today. Just to evaluate cataract with a torch and going ahead with surgery is not acceptable. And to say that retina evaluation is a specialty thing, it's not. To look at the fundus is not a specialty. Everyone must do a slit lamp evaluation. And whenever you find there is a difference in vision, even though the cataract looks the same on slit lamp, you must immediately rule out other causes of vision loss. That's a very, very basic principle. Check for RAPD, and we have known glaucoma specialists missing macular hole. The macula fovea is not too far away from the disc. As you pointed out, Srinivas, about the elephant, a glaucoma specialist can miss macular hole, and the same way, reverse also happens. A retina specialist, a macular specialist misses glaucoma. They are not far away. But the point here is we should look at patients as a whole and try to make sure that everything is matching what we are expecting, what the symptoms are, what the vision is. Only then we will be able to do the next steps, injection, referral, all those things come as the next step, which the next speakers are going to talk about. Excellent talk, Srinivas. Over to you, Naresh.
Thank you, Rajesh.
I think the next one is by Dr. S.K. Mishra from R&R Hospital. Comorbidities are the biggest problem, and especially to tertiary care, all the comorbidities are referred. Especially we have seen people with the HbA1c higher than the hemoglobin of the patient. So how we are going to manage the comorbidities in the clinical practice? I think over to Dr. S.K. Mishra of R&R Hospital. Over to you, sir.
Thank you very much. I must, at the outset, I would like to thank the AS for giving me this opportunity to present my thoughts on the comorbidities in my clinical practice. So I would like to first divide my comorbidities into two parts, that is non-infectious and infectious. First, I will cover the non-infectious part. Non-infectious, the first and foremost is the endocrine part, where we have diabetes and thyroid, connective tissue disorders, where rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, PAN, and systemic sclerosis come into play, sarcoidosis, VKH, and I would also like to mention about the clinical-assisted vitreoretinal surgeries, the conditions where we use that. Then the infectious part, where it is HIV, TB, herpes simplex, syphilis. Now I come to the non-infectious part, and the most important of them is diabetic retinopathy. As we all know, it has been explained in detail by Dr. Srinivas that we do get diabetic retinopathy in various stages, right from the early non-proliferative diabetic retinopathy to proliferative diabetic retinopathy. So for the general ophthalmologist to diagnose the basic retinopathy and send it to us is very important. So one has to keep in mind the long duration of disease. The factors which lead to diabetic retinopathy is long duration of disease, poor metabolic control, hypertension, renal disease, and pregnancy. The other risk factors include obesity, hyperlipidemia, and smoking. So these are the various signs of the background and proliferative diabetic retinopathy in form of, even can see in the left top side is the IRMAs, the NVDs, there's a vascular proliferation, neovascularization on the disc, then the venous bleeding, and the NVE. So these are the features one must keep into the mind to look for the diabetic changes. The treatment, we all know that it's a strict glycemic control, anti-VEGFs, intraocular steroids, PRP, and role of vitrectomy. PRP is mandatory in case of PDR, and vitrectomy in case of other complications like non-resolving vitreous hemorrhage. Other comorbidity is important one is hypertension, as it has been classified and gone into detail by Dr. Joshi. It consists of retinopathy, optic neuropathy, and choroidopathy. The risk factors include a chronically elevated blood pressure, essential hypertension, and hypertension secondary to pheochromocytoma, hyperaldosteronism, and renal vascular disease. So the signs of background retinopathy, we all know that it could range from superficial hemorrhages to AV sign changes to the optic disc changes in form of disc edema and hemorrhages. So we all know that treatment is, primary prevention is routine blood pressure monitoring, antihypertensive medications, and regular follow-up. And we all know that hypertensive retinopathy is also a predisposition to retinal vascular diseases like RVOs. It can also cause chronic papilledema, leading to optic nerve atrophy. Thyroid eye disease, we all know it involves the soft tissue involvement in periorbital and conjunctival tissues. It can cause chemosis, eyelid retraction, proptosis, and optic neuropathy with restrictive myopathy. Proptosis may be associated with choroidal folds. The treatment includes systemic steroids, radiotherapy, and surgical decompression. Then is sarcoidosis. It's an idiopathic multisystem disorder characterized by non-caseating granulomas. The systemic involvement, lung lesion, it happens in 95% of cases, in thoracic lymph node 50, skin and eye lesion in 30% of cases. Retina, we have patchy venous sheathing, cellular infiltrate around the vessels, choroidal granulomas and neovascularizations, and infiltration in the vitreous in form of snowball opacities. Treatment as systemic steroids in patients with posterior segment disease, especially when vision is threatened and optic nerve is involved, and immunosuppressions. The temporary keratoprosthesis, it's a triple procedure with the pars plana vitrectomy and a temporary keratoprosthesis with penetrating keratoplasty in cases where there is a trauma or corneal pacification along with the vitreous disorders. Open globe trauma complex has multiple intraocular structures disorganization. A PPV, TKP, and PKP need some modification in such conditions. Post-operative hypotonia is common and silicon oil is often used. This is a small video of a procedure of a temporary keratoprosthesis. You can see the cornea is badly damaged. You can't see the posterior segment at all. So the cornea. Corneal button is being removed and a temporary keratoprosthesis is placed on top of it and sutured to the sclera. The vitrectomy is performed. You can see the bad condition, the extremely puckered, and the retina is completely. Hello? The PFCL has been put. Membrane peeling is being done and endo laser, and followed by PK. Then I come to the infectious part. We have HIV in that. The ocular manifestation include eyelids and it includes from eyelids to the optic nerve. The HIV virus can be isolated from the cornea, conjunctival epithelium, tears, and retina. It can present as dry eyes, then retinal microvasculopathy and CMV retinitis. Retinal microvasculopathy includes small dot hemorrhages and cotton wool spots. Most common finding is a non-infective retinopathy characterized by cotton wool spots, retinal hemorrhages, and microvascular disease. It appears as a depigmented fundus with retinal artery attenuation. You can see there's an autopsy proven human HIV virus infection of the retina. optic disc pallor can be seen along with retinal attenuation and depigmented fundus. The arterial deposition of immunoglobulin complex in the region around the cotton wool spots suggests that it's an immune complex mediated disease rather than a direct viral infection. Other common ocular manifestation of AIDS could include HIV, CMV retinitis, and conjunctival Kaposi's sarcoma. Then the tuberculosis. It's a leading cause of posterior uveitis. Ocular manifestation depends on the virulence of organism, degree of hypersensitivity, and extent of host resistance. It does cause chronic granulomatous iridocyclitis. Most common form of this disease is a posterior multifocal choroiditis with or without overlying retinal necrosis. You can see on the left side choroidal tubercle in cases of miliary tuberculosis and retinal necrosis in tuberculosis. Serpiginous choroiditis and retinal peripheritis have also been reported with increasing frequency. Fluoride multifocal retinal choroiditis is seen in patients with HIV or in miliary tuberculosis. Diagnosis, a clinical suspicion, especially in our setting where we have to think of tuberculosis as one of the prime cause of all these diseases. If you can see a tubercle, it's a clinical diagnosis of a tubercle, and also doing lab tests in form of the PCR from the fluid taken from the eye, or also from the other tests, the skin test, and as well as the chest X-ray. The effective form of therapy, we know that it requires rifampicin as well as INH for 9 months, and also use of concomitant steroids in case to reduce inflammation under the cover of ATT. Then comes herpes simplex virus. It's an activation of the latent virus which can occur in cases of fever and any condition which reduces the body immunity or also emotional stress. The eye manifestation include recurrent follicular conjunctivitis, nephritis, keratitis, or uveitis. Chorioretinitis is usually associated with congenital infection. Herpetic chorioretinitis is often accompanied by anterior uveitis. Multifocal areas of retinal whitening secondary to retinal necrosis can be seen in acute phase. It can also present with choroidal hemorrhages, vitreous opacities, retinal edema, and retinal vascular occlusions. Acute retinal necrosis can happen in primary or secondary acquired HSV infection, which is characterized by vitritis, area of retinal necrosis, retinal vasculitis, and retinal edema. Visual prognosis depends on the anatomical zone which is involved and also on the severity of inflammation. It is diagnosed by identifying the virus, presence of virus intraocularly by polymerase chain reaction or immunohistological studies. The treatment is, the drug of choice is intravenous acyclovir. Systemic corticosteroids may be used to reduce the inflammation. Syphilis. Ocular involvement can be seen in the congenital, secondary or tertiary disease. Vitritis has been reported as a manifestation of syphilis in HIV patients. Posterior uveitis in congenital form is characterized by bilateral chorioretinitis, which may be active after the birth. In secondary disease, there may be associated pink nodules, which represent the area of neovascularization. The most common segment finding is patchy diffuse chorioretinitis with vitritis. There may be associated retinal vasculitis resulting in retinal vascular sheathing, retinal hemorrhages, perivasculitis, or retinal vascular occlusion. You can see this is the common presentation where you can see a widespread chororetinal degeneration in the patient with tertiary syphilis. Acute visual loss can be reversed with initial therapy. It is diagnosed by serological testing in VDRN and RPR, and also in the FDA-ABS test, which is the most specific form of test. The treatment is penicillin G. You can see the extensive vitritis, which is when the patient is treated with penicillin, this vitritis goes away and you can see the retina. In case patient is allergic to penicillin, one can start with tetracycline, erythromycin, or cephalosporin. And in patients with concurrent HIV infection, a chronic maintenance antibiotic therapy may be required. You can see the patient whose the papillitis and retinitis being cleared up with penicillin therapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanjay Mishra. That was a nice overview of the comorbidities. But actually, my problem with this comorbidities is like, I would like to tell that most of us are having isolated eye hospital. So not in a multi-specialty hospital. So my question to you is, it is more about forming a team. Like, for example, the responsibility of treating retinopathy lies with us, but the responsibility of treating the diabetes lies with their diabetologists, or in case of nephropathy with their nephrologists. And most of these uveal conditions are associated with the dermatologist or venereologist intervention. So my question to you is, how do you form a team actually, or how do you communicate between the specialists to get these conditions under control?
Could you please repeat it, because there was a net issue. I couldn't hear the question, please.
Yeah, no, my question is like the comorbidities management requires the team of a lot of specialists. Like, for example, diabetes, like we are all in isolated eye hospital. We don't have an in-house diabetologist. And second thing is, patient is coming to us only for the eye, and they don't come to us for the diabetes control. But diabetes control is important. I'm just saying for an example. So my question is, how do you form a team in controlling, or how do you communicate between the, with the specialist to get the patient's conditions controlled?
Luckily, I'm working in a hospital, which is a tertiary care hospital, and we have all the subspecialties with us. So anybody who comes, who's referred from the from a smaller hospital to us, we have a set of the entire subspecialties with us. So he is taken care by the endocrinologist or a rheumatologist, wherever it is, nephrologist. We have a team along with us. So as far as this is concerned, the patient as such is taken care in a wholesale manner. So there's no problem with us in managing those cases.
Because that is the biggest challenge we come across.
I know it is. You know, if it could be a challenge if you're working in a standalone eye center. But luckily for us, it's a tertiary care center. We have all the subspecialties. So that issue is taken care of.
And even within the specialty also, like a thyroid ophthalmopathy, along with, we'll have to work with the orbit specialist also.
Luckily, we have all the specialists with us. So there is no problem, because we form a team. So the subspecialists take over all the cases which are belonging to them.
Now, sir, the biggest comorbidity is the COVID-19. So we have a screening sort of from the patient's questionnaire whether they are at a risk or lower risk of COVID. Like in such case, how do you manage this COVID-19?
What we follow in our hospital, that in the OPD complex, we have shifted it from the main hospital to a separate place. The place has been converted as a temporary makeshift OPD. So all those cases who report to this OPD complex are seen by a set of specialists, the optometrists and paramedical staff. We have all the facilities, including OCT, there in that setup. And everybody is compulsory. They wear the PPE kit and the patients are examined. Anybody who requires surgical intervention, the first sample of COVID is given in the adjoining setup only. We have a RT-PCR setup. So the first sample of COVID is given and the patient is sent back home. And once we get the report, which is negative, based on that, the patient is called to the main complex. A second COVID test is also given after 7 days. Once that test comes negative, that is two RT-PCR is negative, then within 48 hours, we take up the patient for surgeries. Unless and until the patient is, there's an endophthalmitis, still we do a we have a gene expert, so the result we can get within a few hours, and we take up the patient in the separate OT. We have a COVID OT also, so we take up in that setup. Otherwise, we are very, very particular about protecting ourselves also along with the patients, so that we don't give the infection to others.
Thank you, sir. Over to you, Dr. Raja.
I think a very important topic has been covered. We would like to have is general ophthalmologists who have standalone clinics and are having to manage patients with comorbidities, most commonly it's like cataract surgery. But if they have a patient with significant comorbidities like nephropathy or ischemic heart disease, we should make sure that we have, even if you don't have a full-time physician or an anesthesiologist coming to your clinic, at that time you should have a person standby. That should be a regular practice, because you don't want to end up in a situation where a patient needs emergency care during the surgery. But overall, I would say you have covered a lot of points. I think we can move on to the next presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, the next presentation, actually, Dr. Vishal Agarwal, professor of SMS Medical College, is going to answer a million-dollar question. We all know when to inject, but when to stop and who to inject, I think it's over to Dr. Vishal. Yeah, please go ahead, sir.
Dr. Vishal, you are muted.
Yeah, good afternoon, Dr. Naresh, sir. And thank you, AIOS, Dr. Raja, sir, Dr. Namrata, madam, and Dr. Raja. So I'll be speaking on when to inject and when to stop. And that's a very broad topic. So I'll try to make it brief and, you know, to make a point here. So multiple antivascular endothelial growth factors and steroid therapies are now available for macular pathologies of various, you know, diseases. And the need at present is for early determination of the best treatment for a particular patient, of course, to prevent irreversible vision loss. The problem here is there is a substantial cost and visit burden associated with all these injections. Therefore, determining the optimal treatment regimen is very critical. So the question is, are we injecting too often, whether it is diabetes, diabetic macular edema, whether it is neovascular AMD, or whether any other disease related to the macula? Are we injecting too often? Personally, I feel most likely. And individualized treatment schedule allows efficient dosing of anti-VEGF therapy, and we know that. So the point is, minimizing the amount of time edema is present while requiring the fewest possible injections and patient visits. So this balance has to be achieved. So there are so many diseases in which these injections are, you know, indicated, and it's impossible to cover all of them. But I'll be just, you know, talking briefly about the most common scenarios we face in the OPD, a general practitioner faces in the OPD, and that is diabetic macular edema and neovascular AMD, and a brief about some miscellaneous conditions also. So coming to diabetic macular edema, among patients with diabetic retinopathy, we all know that DME is the leading cause of visual loss. And in the current era, imaging modalities like OCT, OCT angiography, fluorescein angiography, play an important role in deciding the treatment protocol, and of course, prognosticating the outcome. Anti-VEGF therapy has greatly improved visual prognosis in the last two decades for patients with moderate to severe vision loss, primarily due to center involving diabetic macular edema. That is the macular edema which is involving the foveal center. And it has become the standard of care treatment for diabetic macular edema. So I'll be showing you a few, you know, real-life case scenarios coming to my hospital, to my OPD, and some curious cases where, you know, a discretion of injection or a proper diagnosis can save the injection burden, or versus where there's a definite indication of injection and where it cannot be avoided. So, you know, there can be various permutations and combinations in relation to diabetic macular edema. To, you know, simplify things, we can divide it into broadly three or four categories. The first is the most important, I think, and which is that the edema is involving the foveal center and the patient has a loss of vision. So that is center involving edema with poor vision. So has a clear cut management guideline. Anti-VEGF is the first line of treatment in center involving edema. There is no doubt about it. Spongiform edemas, cystoid macular edemas, they are good prognostic signs. If of course the glycemic control is strict, and the patient is systemically well in the coming follow-up visits, they respond well to anti-VEGF injections. Of course, there are some confounding factors like hyperreflective dots and neurosensory detachments, which suggest a more inflammatory nature of the disease. And maybe the choice of treatment might differ from clinician to clinician, and he or she might add a steroid or switch over to a steroid, or may opt for an intravitreal steroid as the primary mode of treatment. But as far as the large number of cases are concerned, center involving edema with poor vision is a definite indication for treatment, is a definite indication for anti-VEGF treatment as a first-line therapy. And this, as you can see, was a large amount of edema involving the foveal center with a small amount of neurosensory detachments, a few hyperreflected dots also, but the patient responded beautifully to anti-VEGF, and the lower photograph is just 1 month after the first injection, and the patient did fine in the long run. The second is a more confusing a dilemma in terms of management. That is, again, center involving edema, but with excellent vision. So you frequently come across patients, having, grossly, cystic spaces or distorted foveal center, but with good vision, with 6.9 and 6.6 vision. And you actually, diagnose them because an endocrinologist has, or a general ophthalmologist has sent to you because he found some, or she found some, diabetic changes in the fundus. But when you measure the fundus and the patient is, happy with this vision and has no complaints and has been to, has visited your clinic just because he's been referred to. So that is the dilemma. So the point here is a thickened macula, a thickened central macular thickness does not always correlate with your visual acuity. Okay. So that is when you have to discuss with the patient and have to see the patient profile, how to manage. So the photograph here, the OCT pic, which is shown here, is of a center involving macular edema with 6.9 parts vision. The patient was absolutely comfortable. He told me, why do I need treatment? I'm okay. I was just sent here because I was referred to you. And the patient decided to, actually follow up, and we did not inject him with anything. And the patient had excellent glycemic control, and the lower OCT is around 1.5 years follow-up with excellent glycemic control with HbA1c around 7 or 6.8. You can actually see the patient is still maintaining 6.9 vision. You can actually see the edema has gone down. Of course, it's not a complete or normal foveal dip, but still the patient has no complaints. He did not have any complaints 2 years back. He does not have any complaint now. So observation has to be equated with other factors like glycemic control. The patient is having a good glycemic control. If he is compliant to follow up with regular visits, if he is living outside city where there is no follow up facilities available, all these have to be combined along with the patient profile. And of course, if these are not present, if there is a poor glycemic control, the general consensus is to inject with the anti-VEGF. And if the patient is having a good glycemic control, you can observe. So if edema worsens with loss of visual acuity in the follow-up, you inject. If the patient is not compliant, you inject. If the patient is having poor glycemic control, you inject. Otherwise, you can observe. But definitely, these case scenarios are tricky, and you have to make a judgmental call according, taking into account many factors, not just the central macular thickness. The third scenario is a non-center involving edema. So what we have seen is that the patient comes to us with 4 or 5 anti-VEGF injections, and you see the OCT, you see the macula, it is a normal foveal dip, and the vision is also good, 6.9, 6.6, most of these patients have those. And when you see the OCT, there is an edema, but it's away from the fovea, and obscure. The patient has a good glycemic control, and but still was being injected by repeated anti-VEGF. So this is the indication where you can defer or you can stop injecting. So this requires for observation, again, in relation to his glycemic control and frequent follow-ups. And lasers work beautifully. You don't need an anti-VEGF if there's a, a edema present, away from the fovea. So lasers, modified grid lasers work beautifully in these patients. And as you can see in the OCT on the slide, this patient had a parafoveal edema with a 6.9 vision, and we just did a modified grid, and the patient is doing wonderfully even after 8 months of follow-up. And the edema has actually, subsided of course, he had a good glycemic control. Of course, anti-VEGFs are indicated because some percentage of these patients, if the glycemic control is poor, are converted to central involving DME. That again then shifts us to the slide, the scenario number one, where there is a poor vision and a central involving DME and the anti-VEGF is the drug of choice. Then you start injecting. But a parafoveal edema away from the fovea, normal foveal depth, a good visual acuity, a good glycemic control is not an indication, and you have to stop the treatment if he has had treatment before. Macular ischemia is not an indication for injection. So macular ischemia also can be associated with slight amount of macular edema, but it does not corroborate with the visual acuity loss. So a very poor visual acuity with a small amount of edema, you have to be suspicious and you don't have to keep on injecting, because anti-VEGF in these scenarios can actually worsen the situation, can increase the ischemia. So you have to stop injecting, do FFA, and counsel the patient that no amount of treatment would actually improve your vision. The whole point of treatment is to preserve whatever vision you have and not to let it progress. So the physical barriers, the traction involving macula can appear in a cursory look on the OCT as macular edema to an untrained eye. So a taut posterior hyaloid membrane and vitreo macular traction, these are all diabetic macular edema classification on the OCT. And of course, as you can, it's quite obvious that only surgical management will help in these patients. No amount of anti-VEGF, although they have been injecting these days. In these injections, we come across patients, with VMT and TPHM, being injected elsewhere. But actually, there's no benefit because without the relief of traction and removal of the membrane with the pathway and the vitrectomy, these patients won't benefit. So this is a very curious case. And actually, this patient came. This is a one-eyed gentleman, a 40-year-old gentleman with type 1 diabetes. And he had a macula. He had a 6669 vision. And on the OCT, you can see the subtle signs of traction. There is an elevated fibrovascular proliferation on the temporal side. But, it was holding up and the patient was comfortable with the vision. And the glycemic control was okay. The HbA1c was around 7, between 7 and 8. And we advised for follow-up. But he was so keen on treatment. And he was not convinced with our advice, and he went to some other physician, to ophthalmologist, and I don't know, but they might have not figured out these fibrovascular membranes, and in a busy OPD, the fundus findings can also be missed. And they injected anti-VEGF, and then as you can see the below photograph, the traction has evolved, and it had led to a bleed, and there is now a subhyaloid bleed with the elevation of the macula. The vision dropped to finger counting 3 meters, and now we operated him for the posterior pole bleed and the tractional elevation of the macula around 15 days back, and he's doing fine. But these are the disastrous effects of indiscriminate anti-VEGF use in diabetic macular edema. So you have to not just take a look at the central macular thickness, whether there is edema or not. There's so many other confounding factors, associated factors, the patient profile, one-eyed patient, the age, the tractional forces, before telling the patient that he needs a prick. Coming to the next common scenario, which we see in the OPD, is the neovascular AMD. And the hallmark feature is the presence of choroidal or retinal neovascularization. Of course, we all know that if left untreated, it results in permanent vision, central vision loss with the exudation, leakage, and ultimately subretinal fibrosis. And anti-VEGF again has been the standard of care in these in the management of neovascular AMD. So neovascular AMD, in comparison to DME, if you ask, both require anti-VEGF injections, but neovascular AMD is a more aggressive disease. So you need a more aggressive approach in comparison to DME. The aim is to reduce the scar size. Even if there is a scar and there is fluid, you might tend to inject and not observe, because if the scar increases, the resulting scotoma can be very troubling. And we have learned from various trials that Marina, Anchor, and the CAD research group, the injections do not, you can inject anything, bevacizumab, ranibizumab, aflibercept, they all work fine. But the point is, these are chronic conditions, and you have to keep the patient in you know, frequent follow-ups. And although the two-year data in these studies was very good, but the five-year and the seven-year data showed a decrease in visual acuity in the one-third of the patients. And that tells us about the disease process that these are chronic diseases. There is no cure to it. Although you can reduce the scar size and give the patient a quality of life by maintaining good quality vision, but regular follow-ups are important, and regular and aggressive treatment is required as compared to diabetic macular edema. So, of course, dry AMD, Dressonard, PEDs, you just observe. There is a chance of conversion to neovascular edema. Again, the central macular thickness might be more than the normal, but this is not an indication for injection. You should not inject. Of course, if you see a fundus or you have a fundus photography facility in your center, you can just easily make out that there is a fresh bleed at the posterior pore in the left eye. And this is definitely indication for injection, even if the patient is maintaining good vision, because this is approaching the fovea and the vision will decrease when this bleed absorbs and there is a scar tissue which encroaches on the center. So this is the indication, any fresh bleed on the posterior pole. Coming to back to PEDs, these PEDs, you know, require a very thorough and, you know, stringent follow-up. And this patient, you know, had a Dressonard PEDs, large Dressonard PEDs. And you can see the patient was followed for the past 2 or 3 years. And one day he came with a slight metamorphopsy, and you can see these signs, you know, the PED size has increased and there is a cystoid space in the retina and there are some high reflective dots near the pigment epithelium. And these are indications that the activity has started and the patient should be injected as soon as possible, because then the vision will be maintained without the formation of a scar tissue. So PEDs have to be followed very closely and have to be injected when these changes occur. This was a patient, you know, with the neovascular AMD with a, you know, type 1 CNVM, and there was a fluid and the patient came with metamorphopsia with good vision, and we, you know, injected a loading dose of 3 injections ranibizumab every month, and then the patient was on a PRN treatment. PRN is as and when required, and the patient had an initial good response, and for the first 2 years he was very happy and maintaining 6.9 and 6 vision. And as you can see the OCT, the fluid has completely resolved. But then after a couple of years, the fluid again came up, and this was a refractory fluid. And we started with ranibizumab, switched over to aflibercept, but nothing worked actually. And the patient is still maintaining 6.9 vision, but he's mildly symptomatic and we have stopped injecting. The point is the patient will not benefit from drying up the fluid now. And now it is postulated that this fluid has a protective effect on the membrane. So if you try hard and dry the fluid, it can lead to geographical atrophy. So it's time to stop injecting in these patients. There is no point in injecting in a large scar tissue with fluid, and these in our terminology is known as subretinal hyperreflective material. And even if you dry up the overlying fluid, the whole ISOS and the outer retina is gone. The patient will not improve at all. There's no point in injecting patients with such a large tissue at the posterior pole with residual fluid. This is not an indication. You have to stop injecting. OCT angiography is a new modality which has, you know, given a lot of insight in how we treat and how we see, especially in neovascular AMD, because it shows you all the membranes very clearly, and you can, you know, manage your injections and follow up very effectively using OCT angiography. A machine, although it's a very expensive modality, but it has a definite role, especially in neovascular AMD. So the first slide is of a, you know, of a membrane, and you can see the whole membrane, the neovascular network and the anastomosis. And this, of course, is an indication for injection. This patient was associated with fluid and there was a lot of anastomosis. It's an active membrane. It's an indication of injection. You don't need an angiography here. The second slide also, the second octa shows the OCT angiography shows that, dead tree trunk appearance, and there is no anastomosis, there's a scar tissue and just a feeder vessel is left, and there are no anastomosis between the branch vessels. So even if the patient has fluid, this does not, come into the category of injecting anti-VEGFs, because the patient will not benefit. Some residual fluid can be left if there are no anastomosis or there is no activity. Another, neovascular AMD, the patient had a large PED with the, you know, a border, bordering the PD3 for some, you know, intraretinal fluid. And the general consensus a few years back was just to observe these patients. But now with the multimodal imaging and using Octa, you can see a beautiful membrane, a small membrane just hidden behind the large PD. And this, you know, this makes the patient come into the category of injecting, and you have to start injecting anti-VEGF. The patient benefited with it. Coming to extension of CNVMs, myopic CNVMs, these are difficult to diagnose in highly tessellated funduses because the choroidal vessel might appear and give you a false information as if it is a bleed. And sometimes a small membrane can be missed. But the good point is these membranes have a favorable prognosis, myopic CNVMs. They have less recurrences. And the metamorphopsia the patient is complaining might be very, it might not corroborate with the lesion size. So they might be small membranes with very little fluid, but a recent onset metamorphopsia in a myopic patient and a small membrane is a definite indication for start injecting. And these patients are very happy, of course, with less recurrences. Coming to miscellaneous condition of retinal vein occlusions, of course, here the always PRN dosing is preferred and a loading dose of 3 injections is not required in every case. So if the edema recurs, and you have to tell the patient these diseases are prone for recurrences, and this is the same patient, and intravitreal steroid implant like Ozurdex was injected in this, and the patient responded well, and the patient recurred after 6 months, and the patient is now following with reduced macular edema and a normal foveal dip after the second injection. So, and he was consulted before on his first visit that you might most likely require multiple injections. And he was prepared for that. So you have to consult that PRN dosing is there. Whenever the edema occurs, then you will start injecting again. And there will most likely you will have a recurrence of edema. Uveitic CME, again, this patient had multiple injections of Ozurdex and the patient responded beautifully. But in 3 or 4 months, when the implant size got reduced, there was a recurrence of CME. And it was an inflamed eye, and we did a systemic workup and referred the patient to a rheumatologist. He was diagnosed as psoriasis. So this was a psoriatic CME, and the patient was started on azathioprine and steroids, and then we injected Ozurdex after quietening the inflammation. And the patient is maintaining on one Ozurdex for the past 1 year. So systemic control of inflammation can reduce the number of injections in these patients. You just don't indiscriminately start injecting steroid implants in a patient of CME or uveitic CME. You have to, look at the patient as a whole, as was mentioned by the previous speaker, and, refer the patient to a rheumatologist or physician and control the general condition. Start him on steroids or immunosuppressive and then inject, and you can have a reduced injection burden. And every fluid at macula is not macular edema, requiring anti-VEGFs. The most common examples in our OPD are CSR-like conditions. Unless it's a chronic CSR with neovascularization, acute CSRs do not require. There is no evidence that anti-VEGF helps them. And the right side slide is the OCT of a vitelliform degeneration. And these also do not respond to anti-VEGFs and sometimes resolve spontaneously. So fluid at macula is not always an indication for anti-VEGF injections. I just included the slide as an offshoot indication, but these are common real life scenarios, post-operative end-offs. And if there is there are clear guidelines now that if a VR surgeon access is there in your town or if there is an in-house VR surgeon, do not inject, just refer to him. If the VR surgeon is not there, if you live in a practice in a periphery town which is far away from a referral center, of course you have to inject. And then you can send to buy time. And some of the important things and considerations before injecting is doing a sonography and seeing whether there is a retinal detachment or a choroidal detachment on sonography. If there is one present, I would suggest to defer the injection and send immediately to a VR surgeon. So in conclusion, a variety of anti-VEGFs and steroid implants are available at this point of time, and more are coming in pipeline. The first choice in most clinical entities we mentioned is anti-VEGF, and of course you can switch over or have a steroid implant as a primary choice, especially in diabetic macular edema. It's an individual's call to switch over in case of non-response, and of course financial considerations of the patient also. Treatment is variable across patients and even between the eyes, and you have to explain to the patient that there is no permanent cure. We are managing the disease as it comes, and we are maintaining a good vision, and that might require multiple injections. But having said that, we can reduce the dosing by multiple treatment modalities, like loading dose with PRN dosing, treat and extend regimen, or PRN dosing from the start. And that again is an individual's choice. So all three intravitreal injections protocols discussed above can achieve significant visual acuity improvement with reduced, injection load. A treat and extend regimen can provide visual acuity benefits similar to the other two regimens, but with fewer visits and injections. But long-term data and the effect of treat and extend regimen is not well established at present. Injecting, deferring, or stopping finally depends on a host of patient factors in addition to the disease activity. So I was told to, include this slide in the end, that how to diagnose, treat, and when to refer. So I had a presentation 7 or 8 years back, which was, interestingly titled Off with the Label and On with the Bandwagon. And that was, a debate in which I had to say that anti-segments should not inject anti-VEGFs. And over these years, the injections have been, exponentially, the number of injections we are injecting has increased. And a part contribution is by anti-segment surgeons, no offense to them. But my take is still the same. If you don't have a medical retina training, and if you don't have an in-house VR surgeon, it's better to refer these patients, because these are complex diseases with, complex management protocols, and follow-up can be difficult and they can deteriorate, which you are not, you are not ready to, manage. So diagnosis, of course, is by OCT, which everybody has nowadays, and a slit lamp biomicroscope and a fundus camera is an additional benefit. To look for subtle changes, as I mentioned in these guidelines, and they are available on the net also. And when to treat and refer, again, I repeat my point, for diabetic and AMD patients, it's highly recommended not to self-treat unless a medical retina training is present. Some indications where you can manage the patient easily are, posterior subtenous injections for cystoid macular edema post-cataract surgery, or intravitreal antibiotics for endophthalmitis before referring the patient to a VR surgeon. Thank you, AIS, again.
Dr. Raja? Dr. Raja? I think Dr. Raja
is... You are on mute, I think.
Yeah. Go ahead, Dr. Raja.
No, I think very comprehensive talk. And what I would add a little bit is, many times when to stop injection is something which people can have confusion. When to start injecting, in fact, many people think there are many indications for injection. Anything dark you see on OCT is an indication for injection. But anything dark you see on the OCT is not fluid, actually. So there are some which Dr. Vishal has covered. But I would like to say that, there can be some cases where you may mistake some cyst as fluid. It may be, outer retinal tubulation or a degenerative cyst. These are things which only if someone undergoes training in medical retina specialty would be able to make out. It is not so simple that white is no injection and black is injection. That kind of simple algorithm doesn't work. In fact, I have seen many people injecting CSR patients also, or even PFT, parafoveal telangiectasia. So these are some things which someone has to be very careful. And there are now newer terminologies also. In fact, now if you are a retina specialist, by the time you finish your fellowship or another 2-3 years in your practice, you may find new and new terminology, EZ, ISOS, HRD, ORT. So the point is that you should know the basic pathophysiology of what is activity, what is fluid, and how to treat them. So overall, I think you have covered a lot of things. And I would say that people should get trained. That's the main message here, that don't take medical retina or OCT diagnosis very casually. In fact, I wanted to share just one slide, if I can share one slide.
Definitely.
I just show this, that you cannot be just a retina, OCT specialist and claim that I know retina. This was a patient who came to me for opinion on his own, saying that someone had advised injection in this patient, and you see there is fluid, intraretinal fluid, subretinal fluid. He was advised eccentric injection, and he said, you know, I want to take another opinion. So the most important thing for me is to do a clinical examination. Whenever you have something like this, just find out the diagnosis. Edema by itself is not a diagnosis. There has to be a cause for the edema. So when I looked at the patient, there was hardly any changes, no diabetic retinopathy, no hemorrhages, no exudates, no CNVM, nothing. And I wanted to do one more scan. This is the question which came earlier also in Srinivas Joshi's talk. Dr. Naresh Babu had asked, you know, when do you repeat a scan? And this was a fit case for me with one scan, no reason for edema. I said, I have to repeat the scan. And what happened after that? See, actually, it turned out to be a macular hole. If you don't have all the scans, if you take the scan only through the edge of the macular hole, we all know the edge of the macular hole is edematous. So you won't see the hole there. If a scan is going through the edge of the hole, you will see only the edema, this middle photograph. So look at all the scans. So you need to correlate with your clinical assessment, look at all the scans, and then only you should be comfortable taking decisions for patients and injecting. So medical retina is not just about injection or one OCT.
Thanks, Dr. Raja. And before moving on, just a point actually, one area where the injection really wonderfully works is neovascular glaucoma. It's a very definitive indication where you can start and where you can end, actually, because it gives tremendous relief to the people, I mean the patients, and helps us in doing the laser also. And with that, we'll move on to the next talk by Dr. Daresh Raf. He'll be telling us when to start the, refer the cases to a VR surgeon. Over to you, Dr. Daresh Raf.
Yeah, can you hear me? Sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, you're audible and visible.
Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank AIOS for this opportunity. And after all these interesting talks, we are going to move to a little more of a surgical talk. And I'll try to keep it very simple. And also the message in this talk would be basically that to show some of the advances we have in VR surgery so that to kind of inspire or to kind of motivate people that there may be certain cases which in the past we felt nothing could be done for or best left alone. There still are such subsets of such cases, but many of them we can treat with our latest armamentarium of technology, equipment, etc. So when to refer to our VR surgeon, that's how we start. And the most important thing is before we refer, Dr. Raja also told us, you need to examine the retina yourself to assess firstly, what is the diagnosis? And once you do, then we can decide whether it's an early or urgent referral required or it's a routine referral. Some of the cases where I would say not even urgent, but early referral would be retinal detachment. So I'll just show an interesting slide on that. Trauma. So trauma, of course, primary repair can be done by anterior segment. You close the eye, make sure the integrity of the eye is preserved, and then refer for the VR surgeon. Endophthalmitis also, I think it's been beautifully covered by the previous speaker that immediately or after giving intravitreal antibiotics, depending on the availability of a VR surgeon, your experience and comfort level, that is also a cause of early referral. Vitreous hemorrhage is another thing you need to think a bit, what could be the cause. And in diabetic, of course, medical has been beautifully covered before by Dr. Vishal. And so I'll be basically talking about the surgical part of PDR and TRD, which affects the macula. Routine referrals are some of these, the OCT-based referrals, which you say, where you kind of find ERM, lamellar macular holes, macular hole, and certain other situations. Of course, it's a very long list. I've just put a few of them here, where you may have a dislocated, subluxated IOL, which is not causing much collateral damage. So these are the cases which do need to be referred, but there's no need to panic or rush the patient to the VR surgeon. These can be sent to a routine referral to the VR surgeon. So again, going back to what Dr. Raja just showed, and also that image of the elephant, which Srinivas showed. So this is a case which was referred to us as CSR. And of course, unfortunately, the full diagnosis of the patient was not, this is the importance of a good examination. So if we just see this picture, somebody might think this is Shaggy photoreceptors and CSR, but look at the full picture. So the peripheral retina detachment is missed. So the importance of a good clinical exam is highlighted by this. And don't let us become OCT doctors. Let us be comprehensive ophthalmologists and see the patient in totality. Trauma, this is an interesting case of trauma. This was a young boy. So that's why we, even though it was, and although the ultrasound came to us, it looked like a posterior dislocated nucleus on the retina. So the B scan showed a nucleus drop and there was no, so we went in and we looking at, this is not a nucleus. So if you look carefully, this is not a nucleus. This is the entire crumpled up retina. So we put a chandelier. So nowadays with bimanual, we are able to do some things which we could not do in the past because we use both our hands during VR surgery. And just look how crumpled up this retina is. If it was elderly patient, we may or may not have done this, but it was a young 18-year-old boy. So we decided to do this kind of a heroic surgery. And with PFCL also helping us, you can see how the retina opens up. So some of these very bad traumas, which we are seeing after primary repair, they come to us in a very bad condition. Subretinal bands and membranes, like you can see right now, are being removed. And now we try to push the edges, do the laser, and you can see a good, quite a fairly good end result. Patient got counting fingers vision, of course, but at least the retina it attached and integrity of the eyeball is restored. Endophthalmitis, vitrectomy has several advantages, and in the severe endophthalmitis, it is definitely indicated. And these are some of the cases where we are seeing severe endophthalmitis. And this is an interesting case, which was very, very horrific. It was a 21-year-old boy who was going to get married. So he got ICL done and he presented with bilateral endophthalmitis. The ICL was done in both eyes on the same day, simultaneously, same day surgery, which we can have a discussion with the panel. I am not in favor of this. And because the cornea was very involved, you can see very interesting. We were worried about the integrity of the cornea by if we tried to explant the ICL. So we did a lensectomy because it was severe endophthalmitis, it was gram negative. And now we are removing the ICL from the pars plana root. So we are holding it with this one of these forceps, which we used to use in the non-MIVS days. But I think, and also in this, if you notice, we put a 20 gauge cannula and you can see now the ICL is removed. And I think this is, now you will get a view of the lens. So some of these need radical surgery and especially in such cases, we are able to restore, I think about 6/12 vision, we were able to restore bilaterally for this young boy. So I think after this, we sutured the wound, which is also very important. I think there's no role of sutureless surgery for such cases. And you can, if we go back, do we see the kind of exudates at the back? And then we, once we have done this, we continue the vitrectomy and give intravitreal antibiotics at the end of the surgery. Sometimes we have very severe PVR also. And this is another young girl who we operated. So you can see role of vitrectomy in trying to open up these folds. And this is the bimanual maneuver we call tug of war. So this helps us in not having to cut the retina as much as, of course, some cases we need to cut it, but we're trying to avoid retinectomies by doing this bimanual maneuver to remove the circumferential traction in the periphery. And once it's done, we do the laser and silicone oil is injected in the eye. This is the post-op picture, which looks very nice. So this was in fact published just recently last month in the IGO, the tug of war bimanual technique for anterior circumferential PVR. We have described it in recurrent RD, but of course you could use it in any case with severe proliferative vitreoretinopathy. And these are the animations from the IGO article. So we move on to PDR. So PDR of course is another indication. So these are the certain surgical cases where of course diabetic retinopathy basically needs medical management and laser. But like in the above, you can see there's it's forming a tractional macular hole. So this is a case which improved quite well after surgery, as you can see pre and post-op. And the one below, you can see the fibrovascular proliferation with decrease in vision, and you can see the post-op results. So these are the cases we a referral is important because here we can save the vision. And sometimes nowadays with the increased technology, this is not an angiography. This is an OCT angiography with the swept source wide field OCT. Some of these patients, like Colonel Mishra also told us, they have a lot of comorbidities. So maybe some of them, because of kidney issues, fluorescein angiography may or may not be indicated. And other thing is you cannot do it very often, I mean, because it's invasive. So here we can see the preoperative swept source OCT angiography and the postoperative after doing the vitrectomy, how beautifully you can see in the periphery also with the OCT. So just something about surgery and the pathophysiology. So this is why it's important to refer, because this sort of traction on the periphery pulls at the areas of the proliferation, and sometimes you get tears in this area. So these are the ones which look very grim at times, but sometimes they are one-eyed patients, etc. And we would encourage people to refer these so that we can give them the best possible kind of result. And other important thing when we are operating this is the importance of the plane. So now you can see that once you enter the correct plane during the surgery, your surgery becomes much easier. If you're in the wrong plane, you're going to cut into the tissue and you're going to cause large amount of breaks or tears. All these surgeries have been done with the using of a chandelier, which are something we are quite fond of. So with that, we are able to use both your hands for the surgery. In the past, we had to hold a light pipe with one hand, so we only had one hand to do the active surgery. But nowadays, with the chandelier, we are using both the hands. And that, I feel, is, although the time is a little more, but the safety is enhanced by using this technique. And you can see, you can cut close to the vascular arcades as it was without the bleeding, because otherwise you can have a lot of hemorrhage, which kind of compromises the quality of your surgery and the post-operative result. But with this, you can cut close to the arcades without the collateral damage. So other thing is, in diabetic, we have a lot of times we have VR interface issues also. I think Dr. Vishal also has showed this. So some of the, where the VR interface, where there's traction, etc., they do well with some combination of doing a vitrectomy. But the use of vitrectomy for non-tractional DME is controversial. So we'll not go into discussing this in detail. AMD also has been beautifully covered by the last speaker. But there are certain areas where a VR surgeon has a role. So if this is like this huge subretinal hemorrhage involving the fovea, so we find just using the TPA gas and the prone positioning is beautifully displaced the hemorrhage here. And you can see the pre-op OCT above and the post-op OCT where it has got displaced. So this is really good for the patient's vision. Other thing in AMD is nowadays, especially with IPCV or PHCR, we are finding cases where there's bleeding in the periphery. So those are the ones which we need to look for. So whenever there's a bleed, please try to think for the cause. Is it a diabetic vitreoretinitis? Is it AMD related? Or is it because of a PVD? In which case, please, we need to do a detailed indirect ophthalmoscopy. Try to look for any breaks. And these are the cases where nowadays we are doing relatively early vitrect. Earlier, we used to just follow with ultrasound, which we still do. But if there's any suspicion, I think with the technological advances, the vitrectomy does well, and you can give very good vision to these patients in the third category, the PVD-induced vitreoretinitis. AMD-related, this was a patient with a peripheral exudative hemorrhagic chorioretinopathy, which basically is like a form of a peripheral PCV. So you can see the mounds in the periphery, which led to the heme. And once we removed the heme and did the laser, the patient did very well. Now we come to what the OCT evoked referrals I called. Several times ERMs are seen and they are relatively benign. So it's very good to refer these to a VR surgeon, but we don't need to scare the patient or cause any sort of panic. So I'd like to just show you a few examples. So these are the sort of patients where you have good vision with minimal symptomatic ERM. It's just because of the OCT, or clinically we see altered sheen. OCT we find. So please see, so many years follow up this patient we have, say in 2011, but the membrane is just the same. So these are the cases we can keep. Some of the OCTs also look very scary, like this with the lamellar macular hole and this ERM. But this patient was detected because he had to have a cataract surgery. He's 6-9 parts maintained for 3 years. So these are the cases we don't need to panic, just follow them up with a home Amsler charting. So as we conclude, I would like to say that a detailed fundus examination is a key to the decision on referral to a VR surgeon. Please decide whether it's urgent or routine. I mean, it's good to make people aware of their conditions. There may not be a need to scare them in all situations. And have no fear, VR here. I think we have a lot of VR surgeons on this panel. So this is our message I'd like to give everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Shroff. What I expected more was on the nucleus drop, because that is the most common case to be referred to us by cataract surgeon or a general ophthalmologist, because I always felt that a nucleus drop first thing, we should not panic because it is not a negligence, it is a complication. So it's not going to be a medical legal issue as long as we don't hide our nucleus drop. So nucleus drop, and second thing about nucleus drop is, as I have told, dropping the nucleus is not a negligence, but hiding is a negligence. Second thing is, it's not an emergency. It is an urgency, but not an emergency. So you don't need to immediately refer the case. Immediately, you need don't need to take a phone and call your VR friend to refer the case. You can manage as well as possible very well. Place the IOL if possible. See to that it is not dropping. And once it is done, I think you can refer the cases, this thing. And especially whenever there is a PC rent, always go for indirect ophthalmoscopy at the earliest, in the sense of the first post-op date, to look for the cortex which is dropped. If there is a considerable amount of drop is there, then you refer. Otherwise, if it is less than 1 or 2 clock hours, we can still observe. And if the pressure is not rising, but most of the other conditions, like irrespective of whether we tell them or not, they'll be referring us. All this retinal detachment or exudative retinal detachment or any vitreous hemorrhage. But there are areas where they have to refer us, basically the post-op, immediate post-op complication. Over to you, Dr. Raja.
Again, very nice points, Dr. Naresh Babu, and a fantastic talk by Daraz. Very nice videos. So I think he's definitely, those who are near Shroff Center can definitely refer to Daraz. He is such a competent surgeon. The point again, what Dr. Naresh Babu mentioned, it's about referring when you are in a dilemma. So definitely he has mentioned nucleus drop is one common situation. The other thing is, when you have an IOL drop, please don't put another IOL. It becomes extremely difficult to remove two IOLs and then again go in for another IOL. So these are some of the common problems we see, where we want the cataract surgeon, the general ophthalmologist, help in taking the best care of the patient. So there are other situations also. Let's say if you have increased inflammation after surgery, you are not sure whether there is end of or not. Only when a patient has frank hypopyon doesn't mean that is the only situation you have endo. You can pick up endophthalmitis earlier also. So it's always good to have an opinion from the VR colleagues at an earlier stage. And there are, in the key point is that whenever you see a problem in the fundus which you cannot manage or you cannot diagnose what's going on, that's always an indication for referring to a VR surgeon. But overall, yes, I think Daraz has covered a lot of points. And in the interest of time, I think we can move on to the next presentation.
Thank you. Dr. Raja, I think the two IOLs we are talking, one is for the patient and the other one is for the VR surgeon, probably. So last but not the least is by Dr. Diksha Kotoch. She will be talking to us on a very important topic, that is on retinopathy of prematurity screening in the OPD. When to refer, how to manage. Over to you, Dr. Diksha.
Good afternoon to all. At the outset, I would like to thank AIOS, Namrata ma'am, Rajesh sir, and Raja sir for the opportunity. And I'll just share my screen. I'll be talking on retinal screening in the OPD, specifically for ROP. So as we all know that retinopathy of prematurity is a disease of the developing retina specific to preterm infants. And basically the underlying pathological change is retinal neovascularization in response to retinal ischemia. So why we need to know about ROP? Because India is home to the largest number of preterm births in the world. We were in 2010, there were about 3.5 million of these preterm births. And considering that even if about 1/3 of these preterm births have access to neonatal care, it would amount to nearly 1 lakh babies who are able to survive each year who are at risk of developing ROPs requiring screening. And we don't have so many trained vitreoretinal ophthalmologists and even VR surgeons. So at places, probably a comprehensive ophthalmologist only will be called upon to do ROP screening. So we need to learn about this. So why in our country it is important? Because we have a highly variable quality of neonatal care, and across places still the use of unblended and unmonitored supplemental oxygen is there, which increases the risk of treatable ROP. We still lack ROP screening programs in many places, as a result of which a lot of babies do not undergo screening or the screening is delayed. We also lack trained ophthalmologists, and also there is a lack of awareness, not only among pediatricians, neonatologists, but even among ophthalmologists regarding ROP. So basically, ROP management requires at-risk infants that receive carefully timed retinal examinations by an ophthalmologist on a scheduled basis, according to their gestational age at birth and their subsequent disease severity. So for all these steps, we need to basically have three questions answered that we should know as a comprehensive ophthalmologist: which are the babies which need to be screened, what is the time that these screenings should be done, and how to go about the screenings. To answer the first question, whom to screen, all comprehensive ophthalmologists should be aware of what are the current guidelines for screening that are prevalent in the country. And at this time, we are following the universal eye screening guidelines by RBSK, which were given in 2017. So all infants who are born with a birth weight of less than 2 kgs need to be screened for ROP. Those with a gestational age of less than 34 weeks need to be screened. Heavier or older babies, that is between 34 to 36 weeks, need to be screened depending upon the risk factors. If they have had mechanical ventilation, prolonged oxygen therapy, hemodynamic instability, sepsis, or adverse respiratory or cardiac disease profile. So these all infants need to be screened for ROP. When should be screened? So you have to remember this, that they have to be done before day 30 of life. So we follow the day 20 to day 30 strategy. The first screening has to be done within the first month of life. And it is the best practice that if you are not aware of the gestational age, that you do the screening between the third and fourth week of life. Babies who are less than 28 weeks and extremely premature may need screening a week earlier than their other counterparts. And it is important that all babies should be screened at least once before discharge from the SNCU or NICU, because we have in our country, there is a lot of problem where there is a lack of follow-up and they don't come. So if there is even one screening is done before discharge, those parents, they are attuned. So they realize that probably they need to come back for a second screening vis-a-vis those who have never been screened. And to remember that a sick child is more likely to develop ROP. Often we have babies who have presented with stage 5 ROP, and they, because their screening was delayed, they were told that right now the child is very sick, so the child can be screened later on. So this strategy has to be stopped. A sicker child is more likely to develop treatable ROP, and the screening schedule should not be delayed for sick preterm infants. Where to screen? So ideally, the first screening is done within the SNCU or the NICU or the nursery, and the step-down room of the NICU under a radiant warmer is the ideal place. But discharged and stable babies may be screened in the ophthalmologist's clinic. And how to screen? So what is generally done is that the last feed is held, the parents are told not to feed for an hour before the examination. Pupils are dilated with the phenylephrine 2.5% and tropicamide in a concentration 0.4 to 0.8% and or cyclopentolate. So now at the commercial preparation of tropicamide and phenylephrine has 5% phenylephrine. So you can dilute it to half, or you just use it once. Don't repeat the drops, just use it once and just wipe off the excess drops from the cheeks. So these are two steps that need to be done. And if you're using half strength, then the drop may be repeated once more, 10 to 15 minutes apart. You can also use only cyclopentolate to dilate once. And then if the pupil is not dilating, that it may indicate that the disease is severe. So you don't need to keep repeating the drops. So it's better to examine what is happening in the anterior segment rather than just keep on trying to make an effort to dilate the pupil. So most of the time, poor pupillary dilatation is because of tunica vasculosa lentis. So we need to examine for that. So here is how a tunica vasculosa lentis would look like. So these would be vessels which will be radiating at the border of the iris and extending onto the lens surface. And you can visualize this by using the magnification offered with a 20 or a 28 diopter lens and an indirect ophthalmoscope. So how to screen? So the baby should be swaddled with a warm linen wrap as is shown in this photograph. We can use a dextrose suck if required. And it is good to monitor for apnea, bradycardia while in the SNCU. But in the OPD, most of these babies are relatively stable and discharged, and we may not have such facilities. So what generally we do is just keep a small monitor there. And you can use the indirect ophthalmoscope with a 20 or a 28 diopter lens, whatever you are comfortable with, and a speculum and a wire rectus. Now, with initially, as a beginner, it may be difficult to see without the use of the speculum, but with experience, like you can see in this picture, I'm not using the speculum or the depressor. It may be possible to detect the treatable ROP even without depression, because generally, if you're using too much depression, that is the time when babies develop bradycardia. But if you're not using depression, then generally the incidence of apnea bradycardia is very low. So with us, just put, if you have to put in a speculum, just put a drop of paracaine and then wait for some time and then insert the speculum. Even with the insertion of the speculum, generally the view is good enough and you are able to visualize any treatable ROP. But in beginning only, you should not start depressing too much, because then it can cause complications. Now in today's era, we also have wide field digital imaging devices, and with the popularization of the telemedicine for ROP screening, probably photo documentation may become the standard of care, but these are costly devices. For example, this is the RedCam 3. Then we have a lower cost. This is the Forus 3 Netra Neo. This is around 15 lakhs camera. It is also, both of these, the RedCam and the Forus, are contact wide wide field imaging systems. But we also have this, the M2 made in India RedCam, which is basically a holder for our camera, the smartphone, as well as the lens. And we may not be able to capture very wide field images, but posterior pole changes and posterior disease may be captured with this. And there are a few reports of using the wide field optos for imaging for ROP. Well, this facility may not be available to all places, but if we don't have this, a simple drawing, a retinal drawing may be enough if that is done with proper effort and if it is documented clearly. So how do we document? So we have to use standard terms, and standard terms is, for ROP, is the international classification of ROP. The latest revision was in 2005, and we use standard terms in terms of zone, stage, extent, presence or absence of plus disease, and whether or not there are any features of aggressive posterior ROP. So to just show you some photographs of our patients, so this is how a normal preterm retina may look like. So you see the optic disc, these are the vessels, they don't show any dilatation or tortuosity, and you go to the periphery, so you see a grayish zone. So normally also, the temporal retina will vascularize around 40 weeks or so, and the nasal retina gets vascularized earlier. So the temporal retina may be avascular to a variable extent, and we just need to document. So we use the term temporal avascular retina if we see a change like this, where there are no signs of ROP, there is just avascular retina, and there are no changes in the vessels in the posterior, there are no signs of any P plus or plus. So this is physiological. We just need to screen until we see the vascularization has reached zone 3. So here we can see the ora serrata, which is imaged in the lower right picture. So this is normal. So this is just, we have to write that this is immature retina. Then what happens as the stages evolve? So in the first picture, what we are seeing is stage 1. The white arrow is showing a faint white line at the border of the vascular and avascular retina. When this white line develops a volume to it, it becomes the ridge. We may also see some white lesions posterior to the ridge, which are the popcorn lesions. These are small tufts of neovascularization. So the changes of ROP start at the vascular-avascular junction, and this is the garden variety, the staged ROP, which will evolve in stages from 1 to 5. So from 1 to 2, then we go on to stage 3. We have extraretinal fibrovascular proliferation, wherein we have new vessels going above the plane of retina towards the ridge. Then we have a tractional retinal detachment. When it is not involving the fovea, it is stage 4A. And when it is involving the fovea, it becomes stage 4B. And then we have stage 5, which is a total retinal detachment. In our country, we see a lot of aggressive posterior ROP, and it is very important to identify the features of aggressive posterior ROP. I'll just come to that. Sometimes often there is a confusion between a 3 and a 4. So in the top picture, what we see is we are seeing new vessels only, but the retina is not part of the ridge. Whereas in the bottom picture, we see that the retina is also elevated. So the top one is stage 3 and the bottom one is stage 4. Then we come to aggressive posterior ROP. Aggressive posterior ROP, we will not see any stage formation. What we'll predominantly see will dilatation of the vessels and veins predominantly, and tortuosity of the arterioles. Most of the time, the avascular retina will begin from the border of zone 1 or posterior zone 2. And we may see flat new vessels, we may see bleeds, and we will see the kind of the dilatation and tortuosity is frequently out of proportion to any stage. So we do not expect any stage, a typical stage to form in these cases, and they will directly progress to retinal detachment without passing through intervening stages. So there may be hemorrhages associated, there'll be flat new vessels, there will be vascular loop formation. And sometimes, especially if it is very, very posterior, you may not even see too much of dilatation and tortuosity like you're seeing in this bottom picture here. What you'll just see is that there may be just a proliferation which is beginning, and it begins mostly nasal to the optic disc. But the salient feature will be that you'll have an entire zone of avascular retina beyond zone 1 or posterior zone 2. And this is important to identify because this is the early signs of aggressive posterior ROP, and we may not develop any stages in this type of ROP. Typically, ROP is classified as zones. Zone 1 is the most posterior, most aggressive disease. And in this, when the radius of the zone 1 is equal to twice the distance between the disc and the fovea. Zone 2 is up to the equator on the temporal side and up to the ora serrata on the nasal side. And zone 3 is the remaining crescent of retina from the equator to the ora on the temporal side. Again, I just mentioned that there is a type of ROP which is described as zone half or posterior zone 1 ROP. Herein, we will see that the vessels don't even reach the fovea, and there will be just small loops just around the optic disc. We need to identify these because these are very, very aggressive. They have high rates of unfavorable outcomes. They need to be managed very, very aggressively. So there, we don't wait for any plus disease to develop. If we are seeing that vessels haven't even crossed the fovea and you're not sure what to do, it's better to refer to a specialist. Again, this is one of the posterior zone 1 ROPs. We see the entire retina is avascular. We just have some vessels just close to the optic disc, and already we see that there is a pre-retinal hemorrhage and there is already a traction developing nasally. This will just lift up and reach the lens soon. So in terms of the extent, it is described by dividing the retinal surface into 30 degree sectors, and in as many as 12 clock hours can be affected, and the stage of retinopathy can vary among sectors. So you can describe whether this is a 12 clock hour disease, it is 6 clock hours of retinopathy. So that is the way you describe. Then there are certain terms, for example, the threshold ROP, which came from the cryo ROP study. If you have 5 continuous or 8 cumulative clock hours of stage 3 ROP with plus in zone 1 or 2, we call it threshold ROP. Generally, in today's era, we are not waiting for development of threshold disease because we are treating much earlier than this stage. So we are treating at high risk pre-threshold ROP, also known as type 1 ROP, which was given by the ETROP study. And this is, these are the indications for treatment according to ETROP. So any ROP, any stage which is less than threshold in zone one, means anything in zone one requires treatment. Stage two, zone two with plus disease. Stage three, with or without plus in zone two, but less than the definition of threshold, also amounts to treatment requiring ROP. So these are examples of high risk pre-threshold ROP before and after laser photocoagulation showing regression of the disease. Then we need to know about plus and pre-plus. So in the bottom left, right picture, we see that normally we do not expect to see any dilatation or tortuosity of the retinal veins and arterioles. And in the leftmost picture, we are seeing frank plus disease. So there is dilatation of the venules as well as tortuosity of the arterioles. So if there is some, is there are standard photographs from the ICROP which are available, you can download them, keep them on your phone for ready reference. So if you see something which is not equivalent but is also not normal, that is pre-plus. So by definition, plus is at least two quadrants of dilatation and tortuosity of the posterior retinal blood vessels. But if there is something in between normal and plus, that is called as pre-plus disease. What do we mean by pre-plus? It is just an indicator for us that we need to screen closely because it may progress to plus disease or treatment requiring ROP. And what is the significance of plus disease? Plus disease means that this is an ROP that requires treatment. So it is an indication for treatment. Then we may have cases present late with cicatricial ROP. We may have disc drag, macular drag. There may be falciform folds. Those cases are the ones which present late. So what do you do when you have examined the baby first time? So if you see immature retina, but no ROP in zone two or ROP or some features of ROP in zone three, we generally follow up in 2 to 3 weeks. In zone one, if we are seeing immature retina or any ROP stage, either one, two or three, or any features suspicious of aggressive posterior ROP, we have to screen in 1 week or less than that. If we are seeing changes in zone two ROP, but it is stage one only, we can follow in 2 weeks time. If it is stage two in zone two, then we screen 1 to 2 weekly. And if it is stage three, then we screen at least weekly till the time treatment stage develops or the ROP starts regressing. When do you terminate screening? If you are sure that vascularization is complete, or vascularization has reached zone three without any ROP features, and the baby has acquired a postmenstrual age of 45 to 50 weeks, or previously ROP had developed, but at least on two consecutive visits, you are seeing that the ROP is definitely regressing, and or a treatment stage develops wherein you have to go for treatment. So for my take home messages for how to screen would be that we need to learn and practice indirect ophthalmoscopy beginning in adults, and then we will be able to do in children also. We should be knowing the classification and the nomenclature of ROP. We should document our findings clearly, means zone, stage, extent, presence or absence of plus disease. All these things have to be mentioned clearly. The date of the next screening must be documented in the medical records or discharge summary, and important that we communicate to the parents verbally. This is an extremely important step that has to be performed. And when in doubt, it is best to seek a second opinion. Take home message on how to treat: that laser photocoagulation is still the standard of care for most cases of ROP. Whether you want to do green versus diode laser, both are effective. Whatever laser is available, if you are trained, you can do it. Anti-VEGF therapy for selected cases of zone one ROP, if there is a media opacity, may be required. And surgery, we can do either lens sparing vitrectomy for stage 4A ROP and certain cases of stage 4B, and lensectomy vitrectomy for stage 4B and 5 ROP. When to refer? All treatable ROP has to be referred if facilities for treatment are not available, and it has to be early because treatment requires that it should be done within 48 to 72 hours. So any high-risk pre-threshold ROP and any feature of aggressive posterior ROP should be referred. If treated and you're not sure of adequacy or had any difficulty in performing laser, it should be referred promptly. because inadequate treatment is as harmful as no treatment. So to conclude, ROP is an emerging public health problem in India. Blindness from ROP is potentially preventable. Increasing awareness and mandatory screening programs are the need of the hour for our country, and timely screening and treatment can result in favorable outcomes in a majority of cases. Thank you for patient hearing.
Thank you, Dr. Diksha. That was a very, very nice overview of ROP. My only question is, like, most of the time we depend on NICU or the pediatricians to refer the cases to us. But I always felt that it is the gynecologist or the obstetrician who is the first point of contact with the babies. So they are the one who know that the baby is less than 2,000 grams or whatever it may be. So what we insist here is, like, we ask them to just put a letter or inform us so that we'll be following up that baby. So what is your strategy on educating or making the obstetricians aware about ROP?
Sir, I completely agree with you that the point of care should begin with the obstetricians, actually. And we should be educating them through their national societies, and they should be as much a part of ROP screening and treatment programs as our pediatricians or neonatologists. The only thing is that most of the time after the baby is born, they are generally shift them to a new to an NICU or SNCU. But definitely ops, and also the person who has delivered the baby, the parents generally have a very, very good relationship with that doctor. So the importance of gynecologist cannot be underestimated for as far as ROP is concerned. Agree with you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Diksha. Over to you, Dr. Raja, for the final comments and the concluding comments.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Naresh Babu, and all the speakers. You gave a very, very nice, elaborate talk covering all aspects. Regarding Dr. Diksha Katoch's final talk, although I am not an ROP specialist and I don't deal with them, but one thing which I can tell is what we need to learn internally within from our own colleagues is that the way our pediatric ophthalmologists, retina specialists have worked so hard in a collaborative way with pediatricians and neonatologists, that now it has become a standard system. We have a system in the entire country, and we have trained neighboring country ophthalmologists also for ROP screen, and they have developed the same system. We have leaders, stalwarts in ROP screening who have developed systems. But unfortunately, in diabetic retinopathy or any other co-management, we have been lacking significantly. The relationship between a general physician and ophthalmologist in terms of developing a system has not matured so far. And that's why we are at a stage where diabetic retinopathy, in spite of talking among ourselves that this is how we should refer, or do radio campaigns, or you do any other campaign, we still have not developed a system so far. So in this regard, I would like to request Honorary General Secretary of AIS, Dr. Namrata Sharma, that we should work in a way that all diabetologist physicians also come on board for the management of diabetic retinopathy. I think it's high time where we all work together and develop. We have learned a lot from ROP management, the systems that they have developed. It's just that we need to, there are different issues. I cannot say we can be an exact replica of system because there are other challenges, but we definitely need to work together for this. So that overall was the learnings from what Dr. Diksha has mentioned. But overall, the take home from the all the talks today is about when to refer a retina case to a retina specialist, while a comprehensive ophthalmologist may be able to deal with quite a few of the diseases of retina, including if they know how to do lasers. For PDA, it's fine. But whenever we have situations where they are not able to correlate, let's say the most important diagnostic dilemmas include whether the cataract is accounting for the vision loss which the patient has. Whenever you have a situation where the cataract seems to be less, but the vision loss seems to be more, and you are not able to find the cause, that's definitely one area where you should take opinion of a retina specialist who may be able to look at whether it's the macular cause, retinal pathology, optic nerve pathology, and you may be able to, they may be able to tell exactly what the problem is. So, or if there is a comorbidity of retina and cataract. So, if the patient has cataract but also has a known retinal pathology and you are not sure how to deal with that, don't just jump into a cataract surgery first and then say, I will refer it to retina. In fact, you may create complications in such a situation. It's always best to have an opinion from the retina surgeon how to deal with the retina problem. Does it need to be managed before the cataract, or can it be managed at the same time as cataract? It's always good to have an opinion of the cataract surgeon rather than jumping into cataract surgery. It could be ARMD, it could be any other cause too. Obviously, there are some cases like surgical retina cases which you have to refer to a retina surgeon, whether it is a diabetic tractional retinal detachment or rheumatogenous retinal detachment. Even if it is along with a cataract, the VR surgeon would be able to decide whether they would like to have a combined surgery at that time, or they would like to go ahead with the retina surgery before they take care of the cataract. One important point which Dr. Naresh Babu raised was about the nucleus drop, the IOL drop. This is one topic where we can tell you, if managed well, the patient will have excellent visual outcome as if no problem happened. But if someone starts what you call as fishing inside the eye, that can lead to serious problem from a patient who can get 6-6 from a well-managed case of nucleus drop. If it is not well managed, then it can lead to a horrible visual outcome. So please do not hide or postpone any complication of cataract surgery. And also, whenever there is increased inflammation, as I said earlier, only when you have lid edema and hypopyon doesn't mean that the patient has endophthalmitis. You can have early features of endophthalmitis. Please do refer whenever you have a very increased inflammation and you had a regular cataract surgery, but you have a very high amount of inflammation which you were not expecting. That also are cases where you should refer to a retina surgeon early. So overall, I think we had a very, very nice session today. Thank you to all the speakers, and over to you, Dr. Namrata and Dr. Rajesh, for any closing comments.
Thank you so much, Dr. Rajanarayan and Dr. Naresh Babu, for chairing the session and moderating the session respectively. I think, Dr. Raja, you put a very important point. In ROP, I think our teams are already defined, and the pediatrician, the neonatologist, and like Dr. Naresh Babu rightly put, even the obstetrician and the gynecologist should be on the same board as our pediatric ophthalmologist and the person who deals with ROP. And I think across all referral centers, this is more or less well defined. But as far as diabetic retinopathy is concerned, we are still not a very, we can say, a united group. We still don't have that kind of a liaison or that kind of a relationship with our diabetologist or with our physicians in our local areas. And I think something has to be done. Concerted efforts have to be made so that we also define teams in various zones, various states, various cities, to say, you know, that one has to work in a team fashion. We did start this walk-in series, and walk-in series has been done by Alargan. Walk-in patient, what to do, mainly for general ophthalmologists, and there were insights into experts also in the session. But more or less, the message has come across that how to treat a patient, when to refer a patient, and of course, when it goes into the expert hands, then we know that the special care would be taken. So I would like to thank Dr. Rajanarayan and Dr. Naresh Babu for organizing this session and for taking it forward. I would like to thank all the speakers, Dr. Srinivas Joshi, Dr. Vishal Agarwal, Dr. Darius Shroff, Dr. I don't see Colonel Mishra here on the panel here, but I'm sure he's there, Dr. Colonel Mishra, and Dr. Diksha Katoch for being with us today and for enlightening this, and of course Srinivas Joshi. So thank you very much for being here. Can we take a picture, please? A screenshot, if possible, Sunil, if you can take that. And Dr. Rajesh Sinha for co-moderating the session. We hope to have many more such sessions which are targeted for the general ophthalmologist. And I would like the suggestion of all those who are watching us on the Facebook, on the YouTube, as well as on our Zoom platform as to what they would like to know in terms of the topics, because we would like to take up this series forward, because I know that this series, out of all the series that we have, has the highest viewership and has the highest attendance. And this is what our members are looking for. So it will be nice to get suggestions on this. So thank you so much for sparing your Sunday time, Sunday morning here with us today, and for the purpose of education and for the purpose of teaching. I would like to thank Alargan for sponsoring this session, and would like to thank Team AIOS at the headquarter, as well as our audiovisual team, Mr. Kripal Rana and Mr. Sunil, for organizing this and for doing this, you know, webinar after webinar. So thank you very much, and thank you. Hope to see you again on another topic with our speakers and our moderators and our chairperson in Retina again. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you. Thank you.